The Wet album began with a jacuzzi. I was putting off going back into the recording studio because I was tired. I had just finished two projects, the main event and the Art Deco house, where I used burgundy tiles on the exterior walls on two sides of this L-shaped house, so I made an L-shaped pool. The pool had a jacuzzi on one end, which was tiled in black with touches of burgundy and gray. And one afternoon I was in that jacuzzi surrounded by all this beautiful black tile that gleamed like patent leather when it was wet. And I looked at it and thought, this would make a good backdrop for an album cover. It's very simple and sensual. Just me in the water with wet hair. So I asked Mario Casilli, who took the Playboy pictures, to shoot it with the water bubbling and the steam rising. And then we did another version in the wooden hot tub at the barn. So now I thought I had my front and back covers. Now I just had to fill in the album with songs. I like following a theme. Since the concept was wet, I wanted to call it the Wet album, and I thought all the songs should relate to water in some way. There's Harold Arlen's great torch song from the 40s, Come Rain or Come Shine. And when I was 18, I had put it on a list of songs that I wanted to sing. But even in my enthusiasm, I realized a teenager singing a torch song might seem a bit ridiculous, so I never got around to singing it before. And then there were beautiful contemporary ballads like Michel Legrand's song After the Rain and Lalo Schifrin's song On Rainy Afternoons, both with lyrics by the Bergmans. Ironically, the song that was the big breakout hit almost didn't make it onto the album. And the only reason it did was due to the persistence of the songwriters and my son Jason. This was 1979, the height of the disco craze, and Paul Jabara and Bruce Roberts had already given me my first disco hit, The Main Event / Fight, probably what most people remember from that film. Now that they had heard I was doing a new album and they had another song from me called Enough is Enough, but Charles wasn't that fond of it. The bigger problem was, as Bruce pointed out, it was dry as a bone. So I asked if they could add some water, you know? And they quickly came up with a new intro that began like this.
It's raining, it's pouring, my love life is boring me to tears. After all these years, now
so the title became No More Tears. Parenthesis, enough is enough. Meanwhile, Paul had another idea. He thought it would be a real coup if we could put his friend Donna Summer, who was the queen of disco, together with me to sing it. He wanted to bring Donna over to meet me, but somehow he told Charles, and Charles never gave me the message, whatever. So Paul decided to call me directly. Jason happened to answer the phone, and Paul gave him the message. Jason, who was 12 at the time, was less than impressed by most celebrities. But when he heard the name Donna Summer, he got excited because she was his favorite singer, and he played her records all the time. So Paul, Bruce, and Donna came out to my little beach house in Malibu. They played the song, and Jason loved it. So that was a great reason to do it. And he loved Donna. So did I. She was a doll. And I said, of course, I'll do it. Disco was Donna's domain, and she was its fabulous star. I felt like a visitor in her world, because the music requires you to sing on the beat, and that was always hard for me. So I had a question for her when we got to the studio. Is it all right if I sometimes go off the beat? And she just looked at me and said, you're Barbara Streisand and you're asking me how to sing it? Donna was completely down to earth. And we had so much fun doing that duet. There's a very high note in the song, the end of the line.
And we won't raise
And that word, tear, just builds and builds and goes on forever. It's about 17 seconds, to be specific. We were rehearsing the song sitting on stools, and when it came to that high note, we just both went for it. My head went back, my eyes were closed, and it was a challenge, but I held that note. And then I opened my eyes, and Donna was gone. Where was she? She was lying on the floor. She had fallen off her stool. I gasped. I said, "Donna, are you all right?" By this time, everyone was gathered around her, and she was sitting up and waving them away, saying she was fine. But then she turned to me and explained, "I didn't breathe right. I guess I just ran out of air and passed out. But Barbara, when I came to, I couldn't believe it. You were still holding that note." And she started to laugh, and so did I. And, thank God she wasn't hurt. Then Francesco Scavullo took a good photo of the two of us for the cover of the single, which happily went to number one and has played again and again on every dance floor ever since. I remember the last time I saw Donna. It was at our mutual friend David Foster's house, who's a brilliant musician we both worked with many times. She looked wonderful, calm, peaceful, and we reminisced and laughed some more about that day. Soon after that, I was so shocked to read that she was gone. That was hard for me to believe. She was too young and had so much more to give. Donna had an amazing voice, and most of all, she was a lovely person. Jason was absolutely right about her.